Hi, everyone. Being in Florida, coming from Colorado where it's cold and rainy is a shock, I gotta tell you. But I'm really happy to be here. So I'd like to share a little bit about my background. I was born on a farm in upstate New York to very young and very disconnected parents. My parents got married, and 3 months after they got married, my mother went in for birth control to find out she was pregnant with me. And so I was told for much of my life I was a mistake. Now, that's not a great thing to say to a child, because, you know, children integrate things. They take them in, and okay, I'm a mistake. I'm not supposed to be here. So when I was a baby on the farm, the only person that I was connected to was my father's father, my grandfather. And they had neighboring farms, and my grandfather would come every day, and I would be out in the playpen alone, because that's the only thing my parents knew to do with me. And he would come and sit with me, and I would feel a connection with him. I could feel my grandfather. Couldn't feel my mother or father. And so this was like my lifeline. And I have a very good memory. I remember all the way back to my birth. So I remember my grandfather, which is a really good thing, because it let me know that there was love in the world, because I certainly would not have known that with my parents. So my grandfather and I would commune, and but when I was 13 months old, my mother decided that it wasn't right to raise me on a farm, and we moved to Los Angeles. And of course, at 13 months, I did not know that I had left my grandfather. I thought he left me, and I almost died from the disconnection. Babies, as most of you I'm sure know, they need a connection. They need a heart connection. And when that's not there, they don't thrive. So I almost died, and my grandfather did die because I was the only person that he had, I think, ever had that connection with. So I grew up as an only child with these very clueless and disconnected parents, and I was extremely lonely, and I was a very tense child. So when I was 5 years old, by that time, there was all kinds of things going on. I couldn't sleep. I had a nervous cough, biting my nails, all sorts of things. My mother took me to a psychiatrist. And of course, it was my problem, not hers. My mother, by the way, was a rageaholic. And so she was narcissistic. And I was the convenient person to take things out on. My grandmother, her mother, lived with us. And she was also a very messed up person. And so both my mother and my grandmother were like always at me. My father was kind of out of it, didn't protect me from them. And so she takes me to this psychiatrist, and this actually changed my life, because after he talked to me, and then he talked to my mom, and I remember so clearly standing there, and he's this tall, skinny guy, Dr. Cassidy, and he looks at me and he says, "Tell your mother not to yell at you." And I'm thinking, I'm 5 years old. She is not going to listen to me. Why don't you tell her not to yell at me? And then my next thought was, you know what, I can do a better job than you. And that's when I decided that I wanted to be a psychologist. So from then on, after five, when anybody asked me what I wanted to do, I said, I'm going to be a psychologist. So it was always a passion, and I was, thankfully, one of those kids, very, very empathic, who people always came to. So I was doing it when I was little. Everybody would come to me with their problems, and I would happily do everything I could to help them. So I grew up in this household where, being empathic, I could feel my parents' pain a lot. How many of you can feel other people's pain? A lot of people in here are good. So you know that when you can feel other people's pain, it's hard. And when you can feel other people's pain, you want to do something about it. You want to fix them. And so I learned very early to be a caretaker. And what that means is that I learned to put my own feelings aside, because nobody was interested in anything that I felt. How many of you came from families where they were not interested in anything that you felt? Well, not that many. That's amazing. Anyway, they were not interested in what I felt, but I was very interested in what they felt because I could feel their feelings. So I learned to just completely disconnect from my own feelings, which means to disconnect from my own body. And I learned to be very, very, very tuned into their feelings so that I could be a good girl. And maybe if I was a good girl and did everything right and didn't make any mistakes and succeeded and on and on and on, then maybe I would get what I hope was love. But really, there was a huge confusion between love and approval, because every once in a while, I would get a little bit of approval. And it's unfortunate when children grow up believing that love is approval, because then what happens with that is they think it's something that can be earned. But in fact, love cannot be earned. Love is a free gift. Love comes from a full heart. It comes from a full place within us. When we're full of love, and then we share it with others. But my parents weren't full of love. In fact, they were really, really empty. They had no idea how to love. And so what they gave every once in a while was approval. And what happens with kids is that they get very addicted to approval and to doing everything right. And so that's what happened for me. I was a high achiever, doing everything right, getting good grades, on and on and on, in order to try and get approval and being very, very tuned in to other people's feelings. Well, then in my, early 20s, I was, again, a really, really, really miserable person. And I was at UCLA at the time, and I had been in the psychology department, but it was horrible. So I ended up psychology minor, art major, and I was really miserable, and so I went into psychoanalysis. And in psychoanalysis, you lie on the couch and you talk. And every once in a while, the therapist says something. And after 4.5 years of this, my psychiatrist says, well, you're analyzed. So I took that to mean that I was now healthy enough to get married. So I met my husband, and we fell madly in love for 3 weeks. I spent the next 30 years trying to get that 3 weeks back. But in that time, I learned an awful lot. I learned what creates intimacy and what creates distance, what has to happen within me and the other person. Because, of course, I had married somebody just like both of my parents. He was unavailable emotionally, he was angry, he was controlling, he was addicted in many ways, needy. And so I went about trying to be a good girl and do everything right. But, you know, that can only last for so long. And I started to really look at what creates connection between people. And one of the things I noticed is that when both of us were really open to learning about ourselves and open to learning about each other, that's when we would connect. Now, we were able to do that for, minutes on end before one of us would shut down, get triggered, and shut down. Now, but what happened is that I was able to develop the basis of the inner bonding process, because what I realized is that at any given moment, there's only one of two intentions. Either the intention is to learn about loving ourselves and eventually sharing our love, or the intention is to protect against pain, to avoid our pain with some form of controlling behavior. Now, my major form of controlling behavior was to give myself up. I was a caretaker, gave myself up. His major form was to either withdraw or get angry. Well, what happens in a relationship where one person gives themselves up and the other withdraws or gets angry? So this was the dance that we played for a very long time. But we did discover this issue. And so after 8 years of marriage, I realized, okay, you know, if I could stay open to learning and he can stay open to learning, then boy, we could really have that intimacy that we had in the first 3 weeks. Well, easier said than done. But I realized I was really onto something. And so we wrote a book at that time that's done extremely well around the world called Do I Have to Give Up Me to Be Loved by You? Now, the thing is, we spent 7 years writing that book and we fought the whole time. And after it came out, we had people emailing us or writing us at that time. We didn't have email at that time, writing us at that time saying, boy, your relationship sounds just like ours. Sounds like you had a microphone under our bed. So what do you do when you're triggered into fear or triggered into anger? How do you learn? How do you get there when your fears are getting triggered? Well, I didn't know the answer to that because I wasn't able to do that. And by this time, I had been a therapist for quite a long time. And I was busily trying to help people. And I wasn't really happy with the results at all. I didn't like the fact that every time something came up, people had to come running to me for help, that they didn't know what to do on the inner level. They didn't have a process. And I didn't have a process. So at that time, I was on a spiritual path. My husband was an atheist, so this was not well supported. But I was on a spiritual path, and I started to pray for somebody to come into my life. I'd been reading and taking classes and gotten my doctorate and all of that, but still, you know, and I was in all kinds of therapy at that time. I went to every form of therapist you can imagine at that time. And you know what? Not one of them said to me, do you know that you're responsible for your own feelings? That was a concept that I had never heard, that I was responsible for learning to take care of my own feelings, for learning to manage my own feelings, and for causing many of my own feelings. Also, none of the therapists said, do you know that you're abandoning yourself? Not one. So after 17 years of working traditionally, because I was trained traditionally as a therapist, I started to pray for somebody to come into my life that would help create a process that would actually work. And that's when I met my best friend and co-creator of Inner Bonding, Dr. Erica Chopich. And, of course, we had to meet. Spirit made sure we met because she had half the process and I had half the process. And so when we met and started talking about it, we started putting this together, this process that had percolating within each of us. And Spirit was very much a part of that. And that's how we started to create Inner Bonding. That was 31 years ago. And this process has been evolving since then into an unbelievably powerful process. This process, I've just seen absolute miracles, like Stephen was saying, absolute miracles with people who start to practice this process. Their whole lives turn around. Their anxiety, depression, guilt, shame, anger, fear, their relationships, their addictions. It's really amazing what happens. And while, you know, anything that's worth learning takes a lot of practice. Inner bonding takes a lot of practice, but it's not real hard to learn. Just takes practice. But from my point of view, there is nothing more important than practicing learning how to be loving to yourself rather than abandon yourself so that you have love to share with the important people in your life and with others. To me, that's the most glorious experience in life. That's what I was looking for all those years, the sharing of love. And it's with inner bonding. It's with my personal inner bonding practice, which I still do every single day throughout the day, that has enabled me not only to have that profound experience of sharing love, but to have so much peace and so much joy in my life. Because as I said, not only was I an anxious kid, but I was an anxious adult. I was filled with anxiety, which I rarely have now. And when I have it, I know exactly what to do. I know how to go in and deal with that. So I'm going to go through this process with you. Now, does everybody have a chart? We're going to start with the back side where it says inner bonding definitions. You can look at the top part of that whenever you want, but I'm going to start with the bottom. And so that we're all on the same page regarding definitions. Now, when I say core self, or I say essence, or I say soul, or I say inner child, I'm meaning the same thing. This is the spark of divine within us. We all have a spark of the divine within us. And this is who we really are. This part of us is so magnificent, so beautiful. If you've ever had a child and you looked in the child's eyes and you saw the light in there and you started to feel the individuality of that child, the essence of that child, that's what I'm talking about. And we all came into life with that beautiful essence. But what happened for many of us is that we were born into parents like I was who had no idea about their own essence. And if they had no idea who they really were, then they couldn't see us. And in fact, what happened is they projected their own insecurities and their own false beliefs about who they are onto us. And what happened when we didn't get love is that we only had one of two ways of understanding that. Either we were absolutely brilliant, and frankly, I've never met anybody like this, who said, you know what? My parents are clueless. They don't know what they're talking about. They don't know how to love. This has nothing to do with me. And they either checked out because they said, I'm out of here, I'm not gonna stay with this, or they found other ways. They connected with an animal, or they connected with a neighbor, or another relative, with somebody who helped them get through. But what the rest of us did, and certainly everybody I've met, is that we decided that the reason we're not being loved is because there's something wrong with us. We're not good enough. We're inadequate. We're flawed. We're defective. We're just not important enough. Now, that's the beginning of the ego wounded self. That's a core false belief, a core shame false belief that there's something basically and intrinsically wrong with us. Now, as I said, virtually everybody that I've met has that belief on a deep level. And so what happens, as soon as we absorb that belief, and it may even be before you're born, it may be in the first year of life, it may be at 5 when you go to school, it could be at any time. But as soon as we absorb that belief, then we take our essence, this beautiful, wonderful part of who we really are, and we start to hide it away. Because we're saying, well, if I'm not good enough, if I'm not lovable enough, then I gotta hide who I am. And then I've gotta figure out how to be in order to get love and avoid pain and feel safe. And I remember thinking, if only somebody would tell me the rules. What are the rules? I'll do it, I'll follow it. I'll be what you want me to be. Just tell me how to be. But of course, you know, those rules didn't exist. And so I went about pushing away my essence, like everybody I work with, and developing what we call an inner bonding, the wounded self. This is the ego part of us. And this part of us is located in the amygdala, the lower brain, This is the fight or flight aspect of us. This is the survival aspect of us. We all have this, and you know, we needed to learn to survive. And so we developed many, many false beliefs, not just I'm not good enough or I'm inadequate, but oh, if I do things right or if I never make a mistake or if I'm perfect, then I can have control over getting love. If I look right, if I perform right, if I achieve right, then I can have control over getting love. And so we developed a lot of beliefs about being able to control getting love and avoiding pain. And this is what the wounded self is all about. It's about trying to have control in order to feel safe. Of course we wanted to feel safe. Everybody wants to feel safe, and there's nothing wrong with that. And so we had to develop that aspect of us. The problem is that then we grow up, we get into relationships, we're still doing the same thing. We're still feeling like we're not good enough, we've got to prove ourselves, we've got to give ourselves up, or we've got to get angry, or we've got to withdraw to not be controlled, we've got to resist being controlled, we've got to do everything perfectly, we can't make mistakes, we've got to drive ourselves, on and on. We create a lot of stress. Now, how many of you know that research indicates that 90% of illness is due to stress? How many of you know that? Well, you might want to look that up, but the research indicates that stress, what stress does, you see, what stress does in the body is that it puts the blood into the arms and legs for fight or flight. But at the same time, it's robbing the immune system and the organs of the blood and the nutrients that it needs. So if you're operating out of a lot of anxiety and fear, what's happening is instead of this fight or flight response operating because you're being mugged or you're, you know, on a safari and you've gotten attacked by a lion, I mean, that's what it's there for. Instead of that, you're creating this stress by your thinking process, that your thoughts are scaring you. They're telling you all the bad things that are going to happen. They're telling you everything that's wrong with you. How could you have said that? How could you have messed up like that? If you do this, this is going to happen. It's going to be a disaster. On and on. This is what the wounded self does. It goes on and on about what's wrong with you and what's going to happen. That creates a lot of anxiety. Now, when you're in the jungle and a lion attacks, your fight or flight goes in, and you either fight or flee or freeze. If you freeze, what happens is that all the energy gets locked up in your body, and this is what happens with people with PTSD, people have been abused. It all gets frozen in there and creates a ton of anxiety. And the same thing happens when we're telling ourselves these things. We're not running. We're not fighting. It's just going on and on. And so every time this happens, our immune system is losing what it needs. At the same time, the blood goes into the lower brain, not the upper brain. And I don't know if any of you have had the experience, you get into a fight with your partner, and suddenly you can't think well, you can't remember what it is you wanted to do, and that's because, that really does happen, and that's because the blood leaves the upper brain. We can't think as well. When we're triggered, when we're angry, when we're scared, when we're anxious, we don't think as well. And so, of course, that exacerbates the problem. So while we needed that wounded self, and this is the second part of this first page, we needed that wounded self when we were growing up to survive. Now it's really, really getting in the way. And that wounded part of us needs to get healed. If you want to attain real health, you've got to heal the false beliefs of your wounded self. You've got to heal that monkey mind that's going on and on and on and causing you anxiety or depression or guilt or shame or anger or aloneness or emptiness. You need to do healing, and inner bonding is an amazing process for doing that healing. So let's move to the third, the loving adult. And the loving adult is what inner bonding is about developing. The loving adult is who we are when we're connected with our higher self, whatever that is for you, whether it's God or whatever your concept of God is, or whether it's your own higher self, the highest, most glorious part of you, whether it's a spiritual teacher, whether it's a light, whether it's something that exists within you, your own inner wisdom, or exists without, it doesn't really matter. But it's beyond your wounded mind, so that you can tap into a source of wisdom. And so the loving adult is who we are when we're connected with that, and we're open to learning about learning to love ourselves. So the essence part of us just wants to express ourselves. How can I best express all that I am? And the wounded self says, what can I do to be safe, to get love and avoid pain? And the loving adult says, how can I love myself? How can I best support my own highest good and share my love with others? Okay, let's turn to the life path chart. And if we can get that up on the screen, I'd appreciate that. There we go. Okay, so there's two paths in life. There's always two paths. Jesus said there's the wide path and the narrow path. This we call the earthly path of fear and the spiritual path of courage. And because we have free will, we get to choose which path we're going to be on moment by moment. Nobody holds a gun to our head and says, you have to try and control and protect and avoid. And so we get to choose whether we want to, and if you look at the chart here, you'll see that the left side is the path of the wounded self, the right side is the path of the loving adult, and that we have choice, and we can choose to control in the face of fear, or we can choose to learn about love in the face of fear. It's not about not having fear. It's not realistic on this planet to not have fear. There's a lot of scary things that happen. So if you think, well, I can't love until my fear goes away, that's just not true. In fact, it's learning to love yourself first and then share love that actually makes the fear go away. So I'm going to go down this middle section and help you to understand what the inner bonding process is all about. And then I'm going to ask for a volunteer, and maybe you can think about somebody who has a specific issue that you might want to very briefly deal with, an issue in a relationship or an issue about anxiety or depression, a shame that you might want to deal with. I'm going to ask you to come up and we'll do a brief little session so that you can get an idea of what the inner bonding process looks like. And of course, that's going to be brief. I mean, sometimes when I work with people, like I do 5-day intensives and there's only like 12 or 13 people, and sometimes we'll work for an hour or two, but here we're going to have a short process. So, okay, so the purpose of the wounded self, as you can see, is to get love and avoid pain. The purpose of the loving adult is to give love to self and share it with others. So the desire of the wounded self is to get our good feelings, our worth, our lovability, our safety externally from others, from situations, from approval. Now, imagine that you have a child, and instead of you giving child love, you go around to people and say, do you like this child? Is this child okay? Do you want this child? Do you want to take this child and give this child love? Because I don't want to do it. Now, what would happen to the child? The child would feel deeply rejected and abandoned. Well, this is what happens on the inner level. If you think about our feeling self, our essence, as an inner child, as soon as we go outside of ourselves for approval, as soon as we try to control somebody else's feelings about us, we are right away rejecting ourselves. We are saying, I do not want responsibility for defining my own worth. I want somebody else out there to define my worth. And for me, one day I realized, wow, This is a really hard way to live, to always have to be on, to always have to worry about what somebody's thinking. And you know what? How do they know? How does somebody else have the authority to define your worth? And what I realized is that the only one who has the authority to define my worth is my higher guidance, my higher self. And in the inner bonding process, we teach you a very simple way of connecting with that higher wisdom. And so one of the things that I learned that made a huge difference in my life is to define my own worth, my own goodness, my own lovability. And that makes such a difference because then I don't need to look to other people. I don't need to be thinking, oh, what are they thinking of me? Am I doing okay? Am I saying the right thing? How do I look? How am I performing? I don't think about those things anymore because I have defined myself as a basically good human being. What if you decided to define yourself as a basically good, caring, lovable human being? Well, then, if other people were rejecting you or disapproving of you, it would be so much easier to not take it personally. You could say, well, that person's having a bad day, but this doesn't have anything to do with me. So it becomes very important to be learning to define your own worth. And so that's the desire of the loving adult. The loving adult finds joy and peace and safety and love and worth through a spiritual connection, through your connection with a higher power rather than externally with somebody else. Now, this very much affects relationships. Imagine two people getting together and each person not feeling great about themselves and thinking, well, I need a relationship in order to feel lovable, in order to feel okay. Now, one of the things I've learned in all my years of doing this is that we attract people at our common level of self-abandonment or our common level of self-love. So, if you're a person who's not loving yourself and you're feeling insecure and you're looking for somebody, oh, if only this person will come along and love me, then I'll be okay. Well, then you're going to attract somebody who's also looking for somebody to love them. So you get together, these two wounded people, not loving yourselves, and at the beginning, you know, you're giving each other a lot of attention, a lot of approval, but it doesn't take very long before you start to feel like you're not getting the love you want. And the other person starts to feel they're not getting the love you want, and you think, maybe I made a mistake, I picked the wrong person. But no, that's not the issue. Because if you don't do your inner work at that point, you're going to pick another person who doesn't love themselves and is looking for love. And so learning to love and value yourself puts you in the position of being able to attract people who are also loving and valuing themselves. And I got to tell you, this absolutely works. This is the law of attraction. Like attracts like. And so the more you love yourself, the higher your frequency goes, the rate at which you are loving. And that attracts loving people. And so to expect to have a really loving relationship when you're not loving yourself is unrealistic. Now, that doesn't mean if you're in a relationship and you're having problems, this can't be healed. It can't. As you learn to love yourself. And what happens with so many of the people that I work with is that even if only one person of a partner starts to do inner bonding, starts to learn to love themselves, they shift the entire system. One person shifting the system changes the entire system. So if you're motivated to learn inner bonding and you're in a relationship and your partner isn't, don't despair. Most of the people that I work with who do their own inner bonding work, their relationships get better and better. And eventually the partner might say, gosh, I really like what's happening with you. What are you doing? And then they get on board with learning to take loving responsibility for themselves. Okay, so going down the chart to intention, as I said, the intention of the wounded self is to protect against pain and avoid responsibility for feeling it and managing it. And the intent of the loving adult is to feel, learn from, and take responsibility from our pain. Now, all of our pain has information for us. Pain is informational. Like if you're slicing an onion and you slice into your finger, it's going to hurt. The pain is telling you something. It's telling you you're slicing into your finger and you got to stop what you're doing. If you had numbed your hand with Novocaine before slicing the onion, you wouldn't have felt the pain. And you could actually do yourself great damage if you don't feel the physical pain. Exactly the same thing is true on the emotional level. Our pain is here to tell us a lot. Our anxiety, our depression may be telling us that we're abandoning ourselves. Our guilt and shame may be telling us that we're coming from a whole lot of false beliefs. Our anger at others is often a reflection of how we're not taking care of ourselves. Now, anxiety and depression, as I said, can come from other sources. It can come from eating really badly. It can come from a gut that's not balanced. There's a lot of reasons for it. But one of the reasons is self-abandonment. And so I work with a lot of people who have eaten really, really well, and yet they still feel anxious and depressed until they start to practice inner bonding. And they realize that their anxiety and their depression has come from their self-abandonment. And as they learn to love themselves, they're no longer anxious, depressed, guilty, shame, angry, empty, alone. It's very, very powerful. So, moving down to the reaction to pain, you can see on the left side of the chart that the moment we move into the intention to control, to protect, to avoid, our heart closes down. In fact, the whole body closes up. We become contracted. And out of that contracted state is where we turn to a lot of different ways of trying to manage the pain. And I'd like you all to take a minute to look over the reaction to pain of the wounded self. Just take a moment to look over the addictive controlling behaviors that we turn to. And just tune in to, what do you do? Are you addicted to manipulating others with a whole lot of different forms of controlling behavior? Are you addicted to people, to getting love or attention or sex? Are you addicted to substances, to sugar and alcohol or drugs or nicotine? Are you addicted to activities, to surfing the TV or to being on the internet or turning to porn or gambling? Or there's so many. Just take a moment to look over all the things that the wounded self has learned to do to cover over pain, to avoid pain. And then, of course, there's all the medications. There's the anti-anxiety, antidepressants that people take to numb out their pain. Now, you know, all drugs have a very negative effect on the gut flora. And antidepressants, anti-anxieties, any drugs, they all have a very negative effect on the gut flora. And so that also contributes to illness. But when you numb your pain with any of these addictions, and you numb your pain with medication, you are operating blind. Your pain is filled with information. You need that pain. Now, we have two kinds of pain. It's important to understand this. We have the wounded pain that we cause. This is what I've said, the anxiety, depression, guilt, shame, anger, aloneness, emptiness, jealousy, revenge. We cause this by our self-abandonment and our false beliefs. But there's another kind of pain, and this I call the core pain of life. This is the loneliness that we feel when we want to share love with somebody and there's nobody there to share it with, or the person who's there is shut down. This is the heartache and the heartbreak that we feel when people are being unloving to us or to themselves or to others. And the sorrow we feel at, like, even what's going on in our world with our food and our toxicity and all of that. And it's the grief at losing loved ones. It's the helplessness over other people and over situations. These are very, very hard feelings to feel. And when we were little, especially if we weren't being loved or if we were bullied at school or any difficult things that happened when we were little, these are the feelings we felt, but we couldn't afford to feel them, because when you're little, if you don't have somebody who's very loving holding you and comforting you, you actually can't manage those feelings. They're too big, way too big for little children. And so when we were little, we had to learn to avoid our feelings. We learned many ways of abandoning. Basically, we learned four ways of abandoning ourselves. One is, we learned to go up in our head, to stay focused in our mind, like I did. Stayed focused in my mind, completely disconnected from my body. Didn't know what I felt. Took me years after I started to practice inner bonding to be able to know what I felt in a moment. And so many of us, we practice staying in our minds so that we don't have to feel what's going on in our bodies. That's one form of self-abandonment. Another is that we learn to judge ourselves very harshly. Like I said, all these judgments, I'm not good enough, I didn't do it right. That's a big form of self-abandonment. Then we turn to all these addictions, all these ways of avoiding our feelings, substances, processes, people. Another big way of avoiding our feelings. And finally, we take our inner child and hand him or her away to somebody else. You make me feel okay. It's your job to love me. That's a big form of self-abandonment. In fact, the minute we do that, the minute we make somebody else responsible for us, we've already rejected ourselves. We've already abandoned ourselves. And so whatever happens after that, you think you might be feeling rejected by the other person, you've already rejected yourself. You're already going to feel rejected once you make somebody else responsible for how you feel. And so you're perpetuating not feeling good enough the moment you participate in these four ways of abandoning yourself. And I've never met anybody who hasn't learned to do at least some of these. Everybody I work with, when they come to me, they are suffering because they have abandoned themselves. Now, if you go down to the bottom of the left side, you see that while doing these things may numb out the feeling for the moment, like grabbing a donut or something, which I hope none of you do, you know, it comforts for the moment, but in the long run, it doesn't help anything. Like if a child comes to you upset, and instead of addressing the child, you say, oh, here's a cookie, go watch TV. The child is pacified for the moment, but what's happening doesn't get addressed. So when we do these things, the fear increases. We become more insecure, more unsafe. And just take a moment to look at the bottom of the left at what the consequences are for yourself individually and in a relationship. This is where the sadness, the depression, the anxiety, guilt, shame, the jealousy, this is where the codependency, the caretaking, the lack of passion in a relationship, the lack of feeling safe, all of this comes from the self-abandonment. Okay, now let's go over to the right side of the chart, and I'm going to briefly go through with you the six steps of inner bonding, because this is the alternative. This is the alternative to doing all these program things that we've learned to do for so many years. This is what you can turn to when there's anything other than peace inside. Okay, so step one of inner bonding is that you have to be willing to feel your painful feelings. If you're not willing to feel the wounded feelings and learn from them, if you're not willing to feel the core painful feelings, you see, the core painful feelings are what all those addictions are about. Because if you don't learn to lovingly manage these core painful feelings, you've got to avoid them. And so in step one, you are willing to embrace, to compassionately feel all feelings, the wounded ones, the core ones, and to find a place in you that wants responsibility for them, wants responsibility for comforting them, for learning from them, for managing them. That's step one. And we can't proceed until you decide that you're willing to feel your painful feelings rather than continue to avoid them with all of those various ways of abandoning yourself. Now, once you feel your pain, then you move into step two. You move into your heart. You invite the presence of love in and the presence of compassion in. Love and compassion are not feelings we generate in our own body. They are gifts of spirit. When we open to learning, we are inviting the gifts of spirit into our heart. We're inviting the love and compassion into our heart. And in step two, we consciously say, I want to learn about loving myself. That's what creates the loving adult self, is that I want to learn about loving myself. I'm inviting in love and compassion. Now, just as if you have a child who's, say, crying, and you say to the child, what's the matter now? Just tell me, what's the matter now? I really want to know what's going on. Is that child going to feel safe to talk to you? Uh-uh. They're going to feel intimidated. They're going to feel scared. They'll probably lie to you. Same thing on the inner level. If you're just trying to get rid of your pain, if you're coming from your wounded self and you're saying to yourself, okay, what is it now? What do I need to do? You know, what have I done? Or what's going on? You're not going to get anywhere. But if you're in your heart with compassion for your own feelings, then you move into step three. And step three is a dialogue process where you're asking the feeling part of you, your inner child is the feeling part of you, you're asking, how am I treating you? What am I telling you that's causing these wounded feelings? Or what's happening externally with a person or a situation that's causing these core painful feelings? So we're open to learning. We want to know what's happening. We want to know what we're doing, how we're treating ourselves, or what's happening in the environment that may be causing our loneliness or our heartache or our helplessness, feelings of helplessness over others. You know, helplessness is one of the hardest feelings to feel. Think about what happens on a freeway and you're driving down and somebody cuts you off. How many people get enraged? I mean, there's that road rage where they actually kill people because they won't feel their helplessness. They won't compassionately feel it. I have so many clients who somebody cuts them off on the freeway and they're swearing and they're angry and they're, how can they do this to me? What good is that doing? Is that doing any good at all? That person doesn't hear them. It's already happened. They've already cut you off. You're helpless over the fact that they did that. So it's much better for your immune system to just say, oh, that helplessness is really a tough feeling, but I'm right here. I'm feeling it. I have compassion for myself, that's really a tough thing. Or somebody you're close to is treating themselves really badly. You know, you're into good eating and they're stuffing themselves with junk. How bad does that make you feel to see them do that? It's awful. But As much as you try and convince them, you're helpless. You're helpless over other people. We don't have control over other people. And so learning to manage our helplessness with compassion, with caring, with gentleness, tenderness towards ourselves is very important in keeping ourselves in balance, not going into stress. So in step three, we're exploring. And let's say you feel anxious and you realize you're feeling anxious and you say to yourself, what am I telling you? How am I treating you that's causing this anxiety? And then you go inside and you let that feeling speak to you, that inner child. And that inner child might say to you, you're putting a lot of pressure on me. Boy, you're telling me that I better look good, or I better lose all this weight, or I better perform, or I better get an A, or I better not mess up at this, or you know, I better do something differently. And I feel very pressured when you do that. When you tell me I'm not good enough, you're telling me I'm not good enough the way that I am. You're telling me nobody likes me. You're telling me I'm going to end up in the streets. You're telling me I'll never succeed. There's so many things we could tell ourselves that create anxiety. Well, in step three, we're trying to understand, what are we telling ourselves that's creating this? And once we understand what we're telling ourselves, then we open to learning with the wounded part of ourselves, the part that's up here, that is programmed. And we say, well, there must be a good reason that you're telling this inner child that you can't make a mistake. That it's not okay to make a mistake, that it's not okay to fail. Must be a good reason we're saying that to ourselves. So then we go in and we look at, okay, what do we believe about that? We believe that we can control how people feel about us if we never make a mistake. We can control how people feel about us if we act perfectly. And so it's all about control. And once we get a good idea of the false beliefs that we're coming from, then we move into step four. In step four, we open to our higher guidance, our inner wisdom, our higher self. And the interesting thing that happens in the inner bonding process is that when your intention is to learn about loving yourself, you are able to access that higher wisdom. When your intention is to control or get rid of your pain or to control somebody else, you will not be able to access it, because our higher self exists at a higher frequency than we do. You know, our bodies are fairly dense. They operate at a low frequency, so we can see each other. Like if we operated like a hummingbird's wings going really, really fast, we wouldn't be able to see each other. That's a very high frequency. So we have to see each other, but we can raise the frequency of our energy. And the intention to learn about loving ourselves, starting with loving ourselves first, because if we're going to loving others first, we're going to completely bypass ourselves. And that actually can become manipulative. I'll love you so you'll love me. And so we have to start with loving ourselves first. And so when we have the intention to learn about loving ourselves, then our frequency goes high enough and we can access our higher wisdom. And so when in step four, we're saying, well, what's the truth about any of these false beliefs? And we start to get truth. And we say, what's the loving action towards myself? What's in my highest good? And so let's say, you know, I've been telling myself that it's not okay to make a mistake. And I go to my guidance. My guidance says, you know, mistakes are a part of life. You can learn from your mistakes. And you know what? Being perfect doesn't have any control over anybody. They're going to do what they're going to do anyway. And there's no such thing as perfect. So then I'd say, well, what's the loving action? And the loving action might be to say to my inner child, you know what? It's okay to make a mistake. It's okay to fall on your face. I'm going to love you anyway. Because you know what? Your lovability is not in your performance. Your lovability is in your kindness. It's in your caring. It's in your compassion. It's in your inherent goodness. It's in your individual form of intelligence and creativity. Think for a moment about how do you choose your friends? Do you choose them based on how they look and the performance, or do you choose them mostly by their kindness, their caring, their generosity? Most people will say, oh, I choose them because they're kind, they're caring, they're generous, they're loving, they support me, they're there for me. Most people will say that. Well, let's say that about ourselves too. Let's choose ourselves because of who we really are inside, our true beautiful essence. And our higher guidance will say, you can love yourself even if you fail. You can love yourself even if somebody doesn't like you. You can love yourself even if you fall on your face. Well, now, when I say that to my inner child, the anxiety goes away. Now, in step five, we have to take the action. We have to actually say it. And then we have to treat ourselves as if we are actually those loving beings. So in step five, we take loving action. Now in step four, we might find all kinds of actions. It might be that we have to stand up to somebody and speak our truth. It might be that we need to change our diet. It might be that we need to read about health. It might be that we need to go back to school or change jobs or start getting some exercise or get more sleep or stop being so hard on ourselves. There's all kinds of things that guidance might tell us about what would be loving to ourselves. So in step five, we now have to do it. If we don't do it, it doesn't mean anything. For example, if a child comes to you and says, I'm hungry, and you say, oh, thank you for sharing, and you don't get food, you're not taking loving action. And so when our inner child lets us in on how we're feeling, and we go to our guidance for loving action, now in step five, we have to take the loving action. And then in step six, we go in and we evaluate, how am I feeling as a result of taking this loving action? Is my anxiety lower? Is my depression less? My guilt, my shame, my emptiness, my anger? Am I feeling some comfort inside as a result of bringing compassion to my loneliness or my helplessness or my heartache? So in step six, we evaluate. And if we're not feeling relief, if we're not feeling better, we go back through the steps until we find the loving action. So take a look at your chart at what happens when you do the six steps of inner bonding. Things start to come alive. You start to feel safe. You start to feel joy. You start to feel peace inside. And one of the big things that happens is that you get all filled up with love. You feel love inside. When you learn to connect to your higher guidance, you learn to bring that love inside, and then you have love to share with others. If you're empty, if you're abandoning yourself, you don't have love to share with others. Lots of times people say to me, well, isn't it selfish just to focus on loving yourself? Actually, it's the least selfish thing to do. What selfishness is abandoning yourself and then making other people responsible for making you okay. They have to give themselves up for you to be okay. It's not at all selfish to do inner bonding and learn to love yourself and take responsibility for your own feelings. Learn to fill yourself up with love so that you're overflowing and you have love to share in the world. And one of the things that happens as people practice inner bonding and they discover more and more about their essence is that the blueprint for their calling, they start to access that, because we all come into life with a blueprint for what we're here to do. Now, I found out really early when I was five what that blueprint was for me, but not everybody finds out so early in their lives what they came to do on this planet. And if you've shoved aside your essence for so long, you may not know what really brings you joy to offer the planet. We are here to offer to the planet our gifts, our talents, our love. That's what fills us up the most, is offering who we really are to the planet. But if you don't know what your calling is, then you might not be offering that. You might be stuck in a job that you don't like, which is not really loving to yourself. But what I've seen over and over and over again is that the more people practice inner bonding, the more they uncover their essence. And eventually, they come in touch with that blueprint. It's there in each and every one of us. And then because they've been practicing inner bonding and developing their loving adult, then they can start to manifest that. Manifestation comes from raising our frequency, taking responsibility for our feelings, being loving to ourselves and filling ourselves with love. Then we're able to manifest our dreams. And so the practice of inner bonding is extremely powerful. As I said, it takes practice. It's not something you learn in a day. But we have a lot of support on our website, innerbonding.com. Lots of ways of learning the process. We have many courses. We have programs. We have free stuff. Lots and lots of free stuff on our website that enables you to get the support you need to learn this process. Okay, so I'd like to take some time now. If somebody would like to come up that has a particular, yes, come on, particular issue. Hi, come on over. Okay, well, thank you. And what's your name?
My name is Sharon. And
hi,
my
Sharon.
Name is Pixie.
Pixie, so which one do you like?
Either.
Okay, so I don't need this, I guess. Okay, so Pixie, what is the issue that you're dealing with?
My daughter, do I speak into this?
Yes.
My daughter is an occupational therapist, married to a policeman. I have two beautiful grandchildren, 10 and 12. And I made the major mistake of letting my granddaughter know 5 years ago that she might have another grandfather who she doesn't know. And my son-in-law and I have had issues, and we haven't spoken in 5 years.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, that is so sad.
Very sad.
Yes, okay. So I'd like you to just breathe inside right now. Breathe inside. And when you think about this issue, what do you feel inside?
I feel really sad.
Sad.
I feel that I was way out of line. He and I have had issues all along for different reasons. And I can't make it all better.
No, so breathe into the sadness. Breathe into the sadness. And get present with that. And find a place in you that wants responsibility for that feeling.
Okay. I've taken responsibility of what I've done wrong.
What you've done, okay, but I want to do it on a little bit other level.
Okay.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So I want you to put your focus in your heart right now. Breathe into your heart. And do you have a source of guidance that you open to? You do?
Yes.
Okay. So I'd like you to open to that source of guidance and invite that love into your heart and consciously move into an intention to learn. Okay. Now, I want you to ask in step three, that was step two, we're going into step three. I want you to ask that sad little girl inside, is there anything that I'm telling you that makes you feel bad about yourself, about this issue? What am I telling you? So ask that. Don't try and
what
answer
am I
it.
Telling myself
yeah.
that makes me feel bad about the situation?
And about you.
About myself.
Yes, about you. What am I telling you that makes you feel bad about you? Just ask the question.
What am I telling myself that makes me feel bad
okay.
about myself?
About yourself, okay. Now, breathe inside. Go inside to that sad little girl. Okay? What does that sad little girl want to say to you about how you're treating her as a result of this?
The sad little girl says that I have to forgive myself and let go and accept it, that I can't change another person.
Okay, but that says to me that you haven't yet forgiven her. So what do you say to her? What do you judge her? Do you tell her? So you judge her?
All of the above.
All of the above. Okay. So what's happening here is that you're keeping this issue in place. You see, you have an external real issue that you did this thing and your son-in-law is upset. But you're keeping the issue in place because you're judging yourself for it. You're telling yourself you did it wrong, you shouldn't have done it, what's the matter with you, right?
Yes.
All that, okay. That's making your little girl inside feel even sadder.
And I get into depressions over it.
Okay.
But I'm close with my daughter and my grandchildren.
Okay, but the depression, I know it's easy to think that the depression is because of the situation, and that's maybe some of it, but some of it is that you're judging yourself, Pixie.
Absolutely.
Yeah, okay. So I'd like you to tune into the part of you. There's a wounded part of you that's really being unmerciful with yourself. And how old do you think you were when you learned to judge yourself?
Very young.
About how old?
Because I had ADHD. Okay. And kind of similar to you, my mom told me what a difficult birth she had with me.
Okay. So, you, what, 3, 4, 5, how old do you think you were when you learned to judge yourself?
10 or 11.
Oh, 10 or 11. Okay.
Yeah.
I learned a lot earlier than that.
Maybe earlier, I'm not sure, but 10 or 11 sticks.
Okay, so I want you to tune into that 10 or 11-year-old right now and say, what do you hope for by judging us about this? What do you hope is going to happen if we judge ourselves enough?
I'm asking myself as a little girl.
Yeah, you're asking the 10, 11-year-old.
What do I hope to accomplish and feel by judging myself?
Okay, now go inside to that 10-year-old.
Okay, I'm there.
Okay, what does she want to say?
I'm lovable, I'm a good person.
No, but so wait a minute. She's judging yourself because she wants you to feel lovable? That's not why she's judging.
Wait. Back it up.
Back it up.
Okay.
Why is she judging? What does she hope to control by judging? What's the point of judging?
To be accepted for who I really am.
So if you judge yourself enough, how will you get accepted for who you really are? How will that lead to acceptance if you judge yourself enough?
Maybe get your parents to approve of you more?
Yeah, okay. So your wounded self, your 10-year-old, says, if I judge myself enough, I'll get myself to do it right, and then maybe my son-in-law will accept me.
Yes.
Right? Okay, so that's what the 10-year-old believes. If I judge myself enough, he'll accept me. But what's actually happening when you judge yourself? Are you accepting yourself?
No.
So you get depressed.
Yes.
You feel bad.
Right. And then I finally realize that they're out there living their lives and I might be staying home getting depressed.
That's right. Okay. So now let's go to your higher guidance and say, what's the truth about judging myself? Am I going to have control over my son-in-law accepting me if I judge myself enough? What's the truth about that?
Truth is no.
No.
Oh.
It's not going to do anything, is it? Okay, so ask your higher guidance, what would be loving to me?
What would be loving for me would be to come to more conferences like this and just live my life the best I can and be around people that love and validate me and accept me for who I am.
Great. And forgive yourself.
And forgive myself.
Yeah. Okay, so how do you, when you think about that, think about forgiving yourself and coming to conferences and being around people who see you and love you and value you. How does that feel inside?
That feels wonderful.
That feels wonderful. Okay, so if you were to start to treat your inner child as somebody worth loving instead of judging her, do you think that she would stop being depressed?
Yes.
Yes.
That's why I go in and out of it.
Right. Even if your son-in-law doesn't come into acceptance. If you do, you won't be depressed. And your happiness is like a magnet.
It won't depend on another person.
Well, and it's also like attracts like. And so your happiness could eventually bring him around. But your depression is not going to.
You might be one of the first to know.
Yeah. Okay, honey, thank you so much for coming up.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Is your book here?
Yes. Well, one of my books is here.
I'm going to buy it.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah. I'd love to answer some of your questions. I love to answer questions, and please don't think that there's any stupid question, because there isn't.
Hello?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you for sharing everything that you just informed us with. It's very beneficial.
Thank you.
One of my issues I just had about a year ago, I had a difficult flight, and now I have anxiety of flying.
Okay, so, you know, that's... what are you telling yourself when you get on the plane?
I don't want to put any thoughts in other people's heads,
yeah,
but ultimately that something bad will happen.
Something bad's going to happen. So, of course, that's going to create anxiety.
Correct.
Now, you see, the fact that you had anxiety then, I also want to suggest, we bring a lot of modalities into inner bonding. It's a six-step process, but we bring a lot of other things in. You had some trauma then.
Yes.
Which created the anxiety. So there's some wonderful trauma therapies, and I want to suggest that you look into, there's two self-help ones that are really excellent. One is called EFT, the Emotional Freedom Technique, and it's a form of tapping on the acupuncture meridians to release the trauma out of your body. And the other is called TRE, which is Trauma Release Exercises. And these are exercises, the research indicates that when we have trauma in our body, and if we don't run or fight, it gets stored inside, and we're supposed to shake. We're supposed to shake when we're traumatized, and if we don't, it gets stuck, and it gets activated. So I want to suggest that you get the book, The Revolutionary Trauma Release Process. Learn the exercises. They're very simple. You can learn EFT online. And then there's other forms of therapy like somatic experiencing, SE, but you have to go to a therapist, and that can be very, very helpful, or EMDR, which is the eye movement, and that also you need to work with somebody. So I really want to suggest that along with learning inner bonding and learning to reassure yourself that you do some trauma release, because that would be very, very helpful for you.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hi there.
Hi.
Awesome. Thank you.
Oh, thank you.
I'm dealing with a health challenge that's pretty significant.
You're dealing with what?
A health challenge. I've got tumors in my head that are benign.
Oh, uh-huh.
It's okay. And I was working with a brand new financial investor at a bank,
mm-hmm.
who I thought I could fully trust. And I really feel like he betrayed my trust and took advantage of my situation, which the reason I'm asking you the question is it's put me in a very stressful situation regarding finances now. So how do I stop it from stressing my body? Because it will be handled somehow or other, but how would I stop it from stressing?
Okay, so see if you can just breathe inside right now. Just breathe inside for a minute. I'll do just very brief. Breathe inside. And so you're feeling anxiety
stressed
over the situation.
And
What are you telling yourself?
How could I let this happen? I trusted a bank. I trusted a
broker.
Okay,
so one of the things you're doing is you're judging yourself for trusting.
Okay.
And that's creating anxiety.
Okay.
But the fact is, people betray us. And we can't always know. Did you have any inkling at all?
Zero.
Zero, okay. So these people were very good at convincing
you. One person, very good.
Very good, yeah. So, sometimes we get an inkling that there's something not right, and then we ignore it, and then we beat ourselves up for that. But you had zero...
2 years later, now I got an inkling.
Yeah,
yes.
Now you got an inkling. Okay, and so, and that happens a lot. We have zero. I mean, I've experienced betrayals, and I had zero indication that this had, you know, was going on. So I really understand what you're going through. You need to forgive yourself, first of all, for not knowing.
Okay.
That's really, really important, to just say, I couldn't know. There was no way for me to know. And what I've had to do in these situations is I've had to open to learning about what is this here to teach me. Because I think everything that happens is part of our soul's journey. And when you open to learning about what is this here to teach you, and you really open on a deep level with your inner guidance, which is your feelings, and your higher guidance, you might get some very, very important information that will help you release the anxiety, the stress about the situation. How do you feel right now hearing that?
Much better.
Much better. Okay, good.
And another thing is with a family member, this person's always trying to tell me what to do and coming at me not from a loving place. So I take it as an attack, and now I'm more conscious because I've gone inward the last 2 years, went to raw vegan, completely changed everything I do. So I'm reacting differently on a much more conscious level.
That's great.
But so I hear what she says, and I kind of, if I come back with something, she says, but you really need to get to work, or you need to do this.
You know, one of the things that's important to understand in interactions mm-hmm. is that there's always two levels of the interaction. There's what you're talking about. Oh, you got to do this, you got to do that. But then there's the level of intention. And in this case, her intention is to control you, right?
It feels that way.
Feels that way. So you have to trust that. So you gotta trust. When it feels like somebody's trying to control you, you just gotta trust it. Take it at face value. So if somebody's trying to control you, you can't talk about the issue itself if somebody's trying to control you, because once somebody's trying to control you, they don't care what you say about it. They're just gonna come back with more control. And so one of the things that's important for us to learn to do when somebody's trying to control us is to speak up for ourselves about that. And so perhaps to say something like I might say if somebody's doing that, I might say, you know, I really appreciate you offering me advice, but I would also appreciate it if you would not offer me advice unless I ask for it. And that way I'm stating what is important for me. I'm not available for advice unless I ask for it. Now, what do you think would happen if you said that to this person?
They would say that they don't want to be responsible for me when I'm older.
Okay, and say, okay.
It's like risky for them not to come at me because they want something to happen. Uh-huh. Looking at that in the future, I might put myself in a very bad position.
Okay, so this person is really not so concerned about you. They're more concerned about themselves and what they're going to have to deal with.
And they may want to try to wake me up as well, who knows?
Right, and you can say, I understand that. But, you know, it's possible for them to talk to you with an intention to learn. See, that's the thing. With the intention to learn. I don't discuss things with people anymore unless I feel like they're open to learning. So, or I might move into an intention to learn. Like in a situation like this, I might say, you know, it feels like you're really upset and trying to control me. There must be a good reason. I'd like to understand what's going on for you. And then see what's happening and see if you can get somewhere with that.
It's my sister, so it's like a back and forth.
Oh, it's your sister.
Thing.
Okay,
yes.
Yeah. Well, I mean, those are difficult dynamics. But as you learn to tune into what is loving to you, and as you learn to open to your higher guidance and ask the question, "What would be loving to me with my sister?" you can get a lot of information.
What would be loving to me with my sister? Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
You're welcome. How are we doing? I think I can take another question. Yes.
Thank you so much for the value you've brought to us today.
Oh, you're welcome.
And this Thank paper, excellent too. I feel like what you're sharing with us is that we come into this world as free spirits, free children, and then we get layered upon layers of prejudice and fear and hate and shame and all this stuff
right.
that adults lay on us. And then you know, like say you hit this teenage, middle age, whatever it is, crisis type thing. And now you're saying that we can become that free child
yes,
again.
We can.
And I guess we need to stand up for ourselves and
right.
develop all these tools and skills
right.
so we can, we can live in a negative world that seems to operate on a lot of negativity and a lot of...
Yeah, but you know, the more people do this, the more people do their own inner work, mm-hmm. the more we raise the frequency of the entire planet.
Right.
It's so important to be doing that.
Right. Yeah, I feel that we can affect all those around us because, like I say, I find people around me so serious about just all the things going on and the alcohol and drugs and all
right,
the addiction.
Right.
So trying to free my, I guess I have to free myself so I can possibly be
yeah,
a key
see,
to,
I,
to free
yeah,
them.
Yeah, the best thing is to be a role model.
Right.
Not to try and get other people to change, but to become mm-hmm. a role model for loving ourselves and living in joy and living in
yeah.
peace and caring about others. That's the way we can have the biggest effect on the world.
Right. Yeah. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Really, really awesome. I've done a lot of inner work. I've done a lot of modalities and healing myself. I didn't walk for several years, and now I walk without assistance and
That's
stuff.
That's great.
But I've come through a period of time that's kind of strange for me. Now, I'm not a smoker, I've never been a smoker, but all of a sudden, I seem to be attracting to myself smokers, and it's like really eating at me. You know, it's beginning to like irritate me. You know, it's like, I don't want to see another smoker. I don't, you know. So that's kind of like the inner thought, inner talk that's beginning to occur.
Well, but maybe the challenge is for you to learn how to stand up for yourself in the face of that. I mean, you know, there's always some reason that something is being brought to us. And maybe the challenge is for you, instead of getting upset, to just, okay, what do I need to do to take care of myself in the face of somebody smoking? And to really ask that question of your higher self, what would be loving to me in the face of somebody smoking?
Yeah, I generally will say, can you smoke somewhere else, please?
Yeah, but you see, when you're telling them to smoke somewhere else, you're trying to control them.
Okay.
What this is about is what we can do. What can I do if I'm with somebody who's smoking? Maybe I'll go somewhere else, or I'll say to them, you know, I just don't like being around smoke, so I'm going to go in another room, or I'm going to go outside. That's what I can do, rather than telling them what to do.
Gotcha.
Okay?
All right.
Okay, thank you. There's one more here.
Thank you for this. It's all very logical, and I've seen a lot of this before. I think for me, the part where I have, maybe you have some tips and tricks, but a lot of it is very logical, where you say, yes, I need to be better to myself, I need to eat healthier, or I need to be less stressed, or, you know, if I'm blaming myself. But the action part, that for me is a difficult part. Do you have any tips and tricks on how can you stop yourself from, you know, sometimes you're really tired, you come home from work, and
you
should do sports, and you're sitting on the couch, and instead of going up and do sport, how can you make your, or
okay.
you lead see, yourself to do the action?
Inner bonding is not about forcing yourself to do it. If you come home and you've decided, oh, you know, I should go out and exercise, but you don't want to, then you do an inner bonding process. You go inside to the part of you who doesn't want to, and you explore that. What is the resistance? Where does it come from? What am I afraid of? What am I telling myself? What do I really need? And you do a deep exploration about why you don't want to. You go fully into the resistance. Resistance is a big issue. I didn't even get much into that, but that's a whole topic in itself, is resistance. We have a lot on our website about resistance, so you might want to read some of the free articles on that. But we don't bypass it. We don't push through it. We don't force ourselves. We go into it. We embrace it. We understand that we always have good reasons for resisting, and we explore it with a deep and compassionate intention to learn. And as you do that, you will uncover the false beliefs that are causing you to be in resistance. And that opens up the space to moving yourself towards doing what's truly loving to yourself.
But some of these things are also quite habit and really intrinsically ingrained almost in your how do you stop from
by, you know, what I want to encourage you to do is start to practice inner bonding, because you will find I had tons of bad habits before I practiced inner bonding, and they're gone. I don't have them. So it's the practice itself. The practice of inner bonding develops your loving adult self. I'm glad you asked this, because one of the things I want to tell everybody is that as you practice inner bonding, you are actually creating new neural pathways in your higher brain. These habits are in your lower brain, but with the practice of inner bonding, you're developing new neural pathways that you start to turn to, new habits. And so it's the practice itself of these six steps that allows you the freedom, that gives you the freedom to now break out of the old habits and into new ones. Okay, we got to move on. Pardon me? It's innerbonding.com. Thank you all so much. I've really enjoyed you. Thank you. Blessings to all of you.